Welcome to my presentation. My talk today is called Open Source and Trusting Water. And many of you might think, you know, what's open source got to do with water? So my talk is about the way that people have to learn things. And the way that you learn to swim can be similar to the way that you learn to be part of open source. So do we have any swimmers here? How many people can swim here? And how many people thought learning to swim was quite easy? And how many people thought it was a bit hard? So, there's no problem with that. Essentially, I mean, learning to swim, it depends on the person. I mean, some people have an actual aptitude for it, and some people take a bit more time. But that doesn't matter. All that matters really is that you learn to swim at the end of the day. And learning to swim actually depends on quite a few things. It depends on your environment, it depends on your teacher, and obviously depends on you too. And some of the key things around learning to swim is about your motivation, to want to learn to swim in the first place. Your confidence at being in the water and doing something, and also your trust, because effectively you've got to trust that the water's not going to swallow you up, you're going to float in the water and actually move in the water. So these three things about motivation, confidence and trust are actually something that's really, really interesting and really, really applicable to open source too. Because being part of an open source community, people tend to be quite motivated. People have confidence in their community and trust other people. So you see the sort of parallel here that I'm trying to draw between swimming and being an open source. So I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about myself. So people ask me about, they say to me, what do you do? And I sort of have to hesitate and sort of think about it a bit, because I've been in IT for quite a while. And if you've been in IT for quite a while, you tend to have done quite a lot of stuff. You tend to move around from place to place. So my background, originally I started as a developer. I spent something like 6 to 8 years as a developer. And then I moved into project management. I became a technical project manager. And then more sort of general project manager. And also into implementing business systems and being the liaison between the business side and also the technical side. So this sort of gap in facilitation. So I worked as a project manager, as PMO, so project management office. So this is around governance and organizing and setting up projects. So making sure that people have the rules and policies and things like that in place to run a proper project. I'm originally from the UK, so I don't know if you can hear my accent there. And I like to travel, and you can probably tell I like to talk too. I like to communicate. And so I travel. I've traveled from the UK, I've worked in New Zealand, I've worked in Europe, so I've been in Belgium and Paris and worked on a lot of international projects. So I enjoy travel, I enjoy communication. And I'm currently based in Prague, in the Czech Republic, and I'm learning Czech, which is quite a difficult language to learn. So I'm learning Czech. I became involved with the Apache Software Foundation in 2008. And I came in via one of the projects called Apache OFBiz. And this was because I was doing work on what people call ERP, so Enterprise Resource Planning. And I saw Apache OFBiz. And it is like an open source ERP, so I thought, oh right, this is something that I know, this is something that I'm quite interested in, so I got involved in that project. So since then, I'm involved in a few other projects as well, so I'm a committer on OFBiz and several other projects, I'm a PMC member too, and I'm also an ASF member. As part of the work that I've been doing as well, I've been involved in a lot of the sort of community management. So when I mentioned my background in project management and being a link between technical and business as well, some of those skills were quite transferable into the open source world. So And that sort of equates to sort of a bit of community management. So I've been doing some work on community management within the communities that I'm involved in, and I'm really enjoying that. So I'm part of Apache Community Development now, and I'm the VP of that. I've also done some work on documentation, so I've written a couple of books. So you see that there's quite a lot of coverage there in what I do. So let's get started in talking about swimming and open source. So my first slide here is called Finding Some Water, and what that means really is about people looking for open source projects to become involved in. So, you know, people are always looking around at open source software. And the reason they're looking around at open source software is because it's quite popular. There's a lot of open source software out there. And the open source software actually solves a problem for them. So all the time, if you're involved in an open source community, an open source project, every day, people are looking at your project. People are looking at your community, and people are making assumptions or making judgments about your community. Let me give you a little story. So I mentioned before that I'm learning Czech, and one of my conversation partners actually is a Java programmer. It was just coincidence. And I said to him, he knows I'm involved in open source, and I said, do you use open source software? And he says, yeah, sure, all the time. I said, well, how? Why? He says, because I look around for tools that can help me in my work. So I said to him, I said, well, how do you select the tools? How do you go about choosing open source software? And he said, well, I look around, I search, and find out what other people have said about an open source community. So notice that he doesn't go straight to the open source community. He's going around finding what other people are saying about the open source community. He said, then the second thing he'll do is look at the community and see whether or not they're releasing at a regular rate. Because he's looking at something to make sure the community is going to endure. So a lot of people put a lot of focus on the fact that we want our community to endure into the long term. But now, you know, other people that are not in our communities also are promoting and thinking that, hey, I want this open source community to endure because I want to look at using their software. The third thing he said that he does, he looks at how the community reacts to things like security. So if somebody reports a bug, a significant bug, is the community quick to react? And if the community and the information that he gets passes all these three criteria, he said, right, okay, I'll add that to my toolbox of open source software. So coming back to this looking around, the main point that I want to highlight here is that people that are looking around for open source communities and open source software, a lot of the information that they're getting is not from within the community. It's they're getting information from outside the community. So it's like people are on the bank watching how you're swimming. So your project is swimming along in the water, and the people along the bank are making notes and watching what you're doing. And it's the people along the bank that are providing the information for the people that are looking. So this is the little sort of analogy I just wanted to throw in there, just to let you know. So that was just something that was quite interesting. My second slide here is about entering the water. So this is about becoming involved with open source. So people that are out there that are thinking about being involved with an open source project, how do they make their sort of first movements, their first intentions known about being involved with an open source project? So there's two main ways you can enter an open source project. You can sort of do something quite small, so you put a toe into the water just to sort of test what's going on, because effectively this may be something that you're not used to, the way that people work in open source. So you might think, well, I'll do something just quite small and see what happens. I maybe sign up to the mailing list, I maybe follow some of the conversations and see what happens. And this is quite an interesting way that people join open source projects, because it's quite low risk. You know, you can sort of, I'll follow it for a few months, and then if it's not interesting, I'll just go away. Nobody's going to notice. The second way that you can join open source projects is you can dive in. And this is, and I see this quite a lot sometimes on some of the mailing lists, because people have come across this new open source project, and they see that it solves a great problem for them, and they're 100% committed, and they say, yes, this is what I'm looking for, I'm going to do everything, I'm going to work really, really hard on this, and they commit themselves 100% in there. So the thing about this is that people may have committed themselves to the project, but they're not sure or not familiar with how the project works. They're making assumptions about how they can contribute. They're making assumptions about how the project will work. So sometimes jumping in, diving in, can be a bit more risky. You can, of course, dive in with other people. So if people joining an open source project as a group, it's quite social. And it's a bit safer than just jumping in alone. So if you've got a group of people, like in this picture here, we've got a group of boys here just jumping in and daring themselves, hey, who's going to go first? If you go, I'll go. So you can join as a group. If you join as a group, you've already got some sort of social interaction there. You're not joining alone, and people feel safer doing something together than they do alone. So this is some of the considerations here around this. This third slide I've got is about being in the water. So being in the water is an analogy for being in the environment around open source, being in a project, being interacting with people. So what do you do when you come somewhere or you join somewhere and you've never been there before? So the first thing that people start to look at is that they think, well, you know, I don't know how everything works. I'm not sure how everything works. So maybe what I need to do is to sort of test the depths, sort of look at what is acceptable and what isn't acceptable. So people can maybe pick up something that's really small, do something, and see what the feedback is, see what the reaction is. Trying to understand the policies, trying to understand the behaviours that are used, that people use in this open source community. So one of the things that you can find when people are in the water of being part of a community is that they bring some assumptions with them, and some of the assumptions that they bring and some of the behaviours they bring are not acceptable. So there's two that you, when people come into a community, there's positives and negatives. So positives is that people can bring new ideas, people can bring their enthusiasm, people can start bringing contributions, but also people can bring behaviours that may be acceptable from where they were working before, but maybe not so acceptable within open source. And by assuming that that behaviour is acceptable, it can cause some conflict and some friction within an open source community. And this thing that I've got here is about being prepared to swallow a little water. So when you're swimming along and you unexpectedly swallow some water, it's unexpected, and also it doesn't taste very nice. So normally you're a bit upset, but it's just sort of a bit of a shock. And being in an open source community can be a bit like that as well, because some of the reactions that you get to some of the things, some of the subjects, some of the way that you interact may be not what you expect. So you may have some what is apparently negative feedback to yourself, and you think, okay, maybe I don't want to be here after all, or maybe this isn't for me, or what have I done? And this misunderstanding of not understanding how the community works is a bit of a setback for you. So here I would like to sort of mention that with the swimming topic, there's two sides to it. So that you have the side of people that are coming into open source, that are new to open source. So these are the people that are trying to learn to swim. but you also have the people that are in open source already that can swim. So on one side, I'm talking mainly here about people coming into open source, but the people that are already in open source, be aware that people are coming in and they may exhibit these behaviors, they may be doing these things, and here are some of the reasons why they might be doing those things. It's because they don't understand. It's not that they're being trying to be negative, it's because that's what they think they need to do. And part of the learning to swim, part of the learning to be a part of an open source community is about being able to sort of mentor these people into the right behavior, into being able to work together as a community. So there's two sides to this as well. So paddling around. So when I was learning to swim, I remember before I could swim, one of the things that I used to do, I don't know if any of you used to do it too, is go into the shallows, put your feet on the ground, and splash around, move your arms funny like this, so it looked like you were swimming. So people that were looking from above or whatever thought that you were swimming. And I thought, and the reason that I did this was because I wanted people to think that I was making progress. So you see people that are making progress, people are doing things, and you haven't achieved that yet. And so you feel like, well, okay, I want to show people that I'm progressing, so I'm pretending to swim. And within open source as well, you can have that in the sense that people can limit their interaction because they're unsure. People can want to not interact with people they don't know. So they prefer to say, right, okay, I know this area, I'm just going to work on this area, I will depend on myself, and I will do it. I'm not going to interact with the community because I feel safer in what I know. And you have people like this in communities as well. So once again, to people that are already in the communities, that have been in the communities a long time, watch out for these people. See if we can do some work to try and help mentor these people. So off on a little topic here. I was at the Open Source Summit a couple of weeks ago, and Rich Bowen did a really, really good talk on mentoring. And one of the things that he mentioned in his talk was that mentoring could be one simple task. So when people think of mentoring, you think of signing up for a mentor for, you know, I don't know, 3 months, 6 months, half a year, or whatever. But by doing micro-mentoring, doing a particular task, you see somebody that needs help. You say to them, hey, you helped them out in this one situation, that's mentoring. So here, if you're in a community and you're looking for people and you've seen people in the situation, micro-mentoring could help. So learning to swim, so learning to be a part of an open source community, learning to interact with an open source community. When I was young, I remember seeing some films on television, and people tried to teach people to swim by throwing them in the water. And the panic of being in the water and not being able to get to the bank was the way of teaching people to swim, because it gave them motivation. Because they weren't going to get out of the water. But to me, I mean, that's a bit of shock. It's a bit shock tactic, and I'm not sure how well it works. I mean, in the films, obviously, it worked because it was a film. But in real life, I mean, I think it's too much of a shock. But you do find people coming into open source communities that are trying to teach themselves about how it works. There's nothing wrong with teaching yourself about how things work, but you can learn a lot more by interacting with people. You can learn a lot more from talking to people, from learning new things. I mean, there's things that I know that you don't know. There's things that you know that I don't know. And the best way that we can work together is by sharing that knowledge. Because some of the problems that I may have may be solved by your knowledge, and some of the problems you have may be solved by my knowledge. And that is the core around the community and the culture around the community, the sharing, the collaboration. So one of the things that I've seen sometimes is where people have taught themselves around technology or a specialism. So you teach yourself, you become expert in a particular area, and you keep that as your topic. And somebody else comes into the community and they're interested in that topic. But because they didn't go through the same experience of learning it as you did, you hold on to your knowledge. It's almost like it took me 2 years to get to where I am today. You've been here only 5 minutes. You need to go through what I went through to be equivalent. And that attitude is not very good. So this is when I say, you know, people teach themselves about being in open source, but you can also have some assumptions of how you would judge other people, because you went through something you want them to go through too. And that isn't always a good attitude to have, because people are different. You're assuming there that everybody's going to be like you, everybody's going to learn like you, and everybody is going to have the same experience as you. And that isn't the strength of the collaboration. That isn't the way that communities work. Communities work through diversity. The communities work by acknowledging that people are different, learn at different rates, like learning to swim, have different specialisms, and by sharing, we can do something together. So, another area is around being able to accept help and support. Now, accepting help and support doesn't mean that you're weak, or doesn't mean that you don't know anything, or doesn't mean that the knowledge that you have is useless. All it means is be open, be willing to accept help from people who want to offer help to you. And open source communities, the essential thing that open source communities want is to endure into the future. One of the things that, you know, you have a community, you have a project, you want it to continue, you want it to go on, you want it to still be here, you know, 5, 10, 15 years from now. But in 5, 10, 15 years from now, I may not be part of the project, or I may want to pass on my knowledge to somebody else. And by accepting help, by collaboration, by passing on the baton to somebody, then that's a way that you can ensure that the project will continue. So, swimming. So swimming is around being in a community, understanding how it works, and understanding your part and how you can work together with the community to do what it needs to do. So swimming, you understand how the community works, you understand the interactions, you understand the diversity of the community, and you understand that by doing things together, you can achieve a lot more than doing stuff alone. And by understanding that, it means that the project can progress. Now, when you have a lot of people together, and I'm sure that if you're in part of open source communities, you understand that not everything is 100% rosy all the time. You have a lot of discussions, you have some disputes, you have some conflicts, etc. But the essential thing is that people are involved in the community, in the project, because they want the project to succeed. They're involved in the project because they care about the project. And so you have a common goal. And what you find is that sometimes people forget that common goal and think, well, actually, you know, am I thinking of the project or am I thinking of me? Am I thinking about what I want more than the project that would benefit the project? So by reminding people about the ultimate goal and how the health of the project in the first place is a lot of the ways that you can actually resolve conflicts. So I've done some previous talk on conflict as well, so I'm not going to go into too much details into that. So I'm going to talk to you about this picture. So this is the picture that I had Right. Yeah, this is Christmas. So this is a picture that I have. This is from ApacheCon. I think it was Vancouver.
Yeah.
Right. And this is one of my trusting the water moments. So trusting the water here is about realizing that collaboration and the Apache way and the community works together. So this is my story. So I was at ApacheCon in Vancouver. So this is TAC. So TAC is Travel Assistance. So what the Apache Foundation does is that we have a conference, annual conference, I think it's sometimes once, sometimes twice a year. And we have travel assistants. So people who couldn't go to the conference can apply and get financial assistance to come to the conference. And that means that for every conference we have maybe sort of 10 to 15 people that come to the conference. And as part of being funded to come to the conference, they act as conference volunteers. Effectively, they help out with the running of the conference. And so I was a TAC volunteer in Vancouver, and so you have a group of 10 to 15 people that have never met each other before. The only thing that they have in common is that they applied and they were involved somehow in Apache. That's it. They're from all different countries, different gender, ethnicities, everything. They're just 10 to 15 people who don't know each other. So I was one of these 10 to 15 people that didn't know each other. So so entering the water. So in this case, one of the things that the TAC people need to do is that they need to help out with the presenters, the speakers. So the task. So we allocate the task to all the TAC volunteers to help introduce the speakers, do the questions, all this sort of stuff. And I was in the group, and the person who normally does the organisation for this allocation of schedule had to go. So they said, "Hey, Sharon, can you organise this?" And I said, "Okay." So I was sort of like dived in to a task that I had no idea how to do. Principally members. So I sort of stood up there in front of all these people that I didn't know, and I had something like a 5 or 6 sheets of paper. And I thought, well, okay, maybe I should just go through time by time. I said, "Monday, 9 o'clock, who's free to do this?" And nobody put their hand up. I said, "Come on, is there anybody free?" And then at right at the back, somebody put a hand up. Okay, Monday, 10 o'clock, who's can do this? And once again, it was sort of like... And it was just so slow. And I thought, oh my gosh. And I stood there for about 2 or 3 minutes. And I said, "I'm really, really sorry, but this technique isn't working. We're not going to be able to allocate all this time in, you know, all these schedules in this time." So effectively, it was sort of like, I feel like my idea was being splashed because it wasn't working. So I said, "Okay, what can we do?" And somebody shouted out, "Hey, why don't you do it by track? You know, there's Internet of Things track, there's clouds track, there's big data track. Maybe some of us are interested in big data, maybe some of us are interested in cloud. We'll just put our hands up if we..." So I tried that. I said, "Right, okay, who's interested in big data?" About 3 or 4 people, yeah. And then clouds, 1 or 2. So what about these other small tracks here? Nobody. Okay, well, maybe this idea isn't working either. So anybody's got any other ideas? And somebody said, "Well, actually, the problem could be that we can't see what you can see. You have all the information. Why don't you just put all the information that you have and share it with us on the table?" And I said, "That's a great idea. Why didn't I think of that?" I put the information down on the table. The 10 to 15 people who'd never ever seen each other before came around and formed an amazing collaborative group. "Oh yeah, that looks great. Oh yeah, I can do that. Oh, I'm interested in that. Hey, I know such and such. I want to do that." And within about, I don't know, 10 to 15 minutes, everything was allocated. Everything was allocated. So I had to accept help. I had to get splashed a little. I had to reach out and accept help. And once I actually asked for help, I asked people for their ideas. People were quite happy to give me their ideas. When I was stood in front of people saying, who's going to do this? Who's going to do that? It didn't really work, because people like to have choice. People like to have a way to contribute. And by sharing that information with them and telling them what the goal needed to be, we achieved what we needed to achieve. And I realized that, you know, we were actually swimming together. We had everything together. It was a collaborative. It was people were really part of the goal. They wanted to help. They wanted to make sure that everything was done. And by the end of the week, I mean, the TAC group becomes a really close-knit group. They help each other. It's an amazing experience. And I think that if I hadn't been part of TAC in Apache, I would not have as much involvement in Apache as I do now, because you get the chance to meet people from all different projects rather than staying in your own project, all the different areas. And I meet a lot of people who are now my friends. You know, I've met them. So realizing that by sharing information, by collaborating, it really does work. This group of people never met each other before. Yet within about 35 minutes, they were working together like a really close team. So it works. It really does work. Empowering people really does work. So I'm going to talk about here being a lifeguard. So being a lifeguard is around the people that have been in the community that help maintain the environment. So when we talk about the community is in charge, and people think that, you know, hey, there's different hierarchies within a community because you have your community religious or whatever. And it isn't, because the community cares for itself. That's what it's about. The community cares for itself. And effectively, everybody's a lifeguard, because everybody has a say in how the community works. People, so I think new people that come into themselves don't realize it. They don't realize the power they have. They think, okay, I'm a newbie. I don't know who's going to listen to me. But if you're a newbie, you're part of the community, your voice counts. Your opinion counts. That's what it is. It's a community. Everybody's opinion counts. So like being a lifeguard is about watching out for negative behavior, things that the community doesn't like or doesn't support, and making sure that people realize this. I mean, I mentioned earlier that sometimes people come into the communities and they don't realize the behaviors they're bringing if they're not accessible. And by communicating that, hey, you're actually within this community, this is the way that we do things, this is how we manage this, we don't do this, we do this. You know, being polite, being open, and being very honest with our feedback. So one of the things also is around giving help and support. So just because you've been in a community for a long time doesn't mean that you don't need help and support. This is the thing about what I say when people think about this hierarchy, they think newbie, committer, PMC, blah, blah, blah. And so by the time people get up this hierarchy, this alleged hierarchy, then they don't need help, they know it all. But no, that's not true. Everybody is an individual. Everybody's an individual. And sometimes, you know, people need help at different times. And even if you've been in the community for a long time, you can need help. And recently I read an article, I think, Isabel sent me the link, about people in open source communities that can burn out. So, you know, people, watch out for people in the community that need help. Watch out for people in the community that are taking on a lot of tasks. Watch out for people in the community that are struggling. I mean, the thing about it is that we want to share. We want to collaborate. We want to share out all the tasks. Now, similar to the TAC experience, if people have the information, they'll help. So it's about watching out and making sure that, you know, your community is safe, that the people, the key people in your community, which is all the people in fact, are not overburdening themselves, they're safe, they feel safe, and helping them. So in my closing, really, it's about making sure that you understand, make sure that you understand how people come into your community, how some of the things that they might bring into the community, as well as their contributions, their behaviours. Trying to make allowances for some of the ways that people might misunderstand how open source communities work. And also as well, being there to be able to offer support and advice for them. Because I think support, advice, mentoring, all of this is we have a lot of information that we can share. And if people realize this, I'm sure that we would achieve a lot more. So it's about being able to understand the true culture of open source, understand the true behavior of open source, and the true objective, which is making sure that the project continues into the future and you being part of it. So thank you very much for listening. And I'd like to see whether or not anybody has any comments or questions as well. So if you have any questions, let me know. I'll pass on the...